Today we're with a group from Buffalo and Happy Valley, and they're going to tell us all about their memories of their childhood days, and it's just going to be an informal conversation. So enjoy.
My name is Herb Miller. I remember the first time I ever met my wife. I met Mary, who later became my wife. I met her at school. She came down to Happy Valley School when I was in the eighth grade, and the school up here didn't go. It was just an elementary school, no high school. And something happened to me that day that I'd never experienced before, and this Buffalo gal, she really tore me up, I tell you. And we started dating. I guess we were 16. Mary, is that right?
Yeah.
And we dated until we were 20 years old, and then we become man and wife. We have 4 children, and we're just so happy and just have been blessed so much with good family and good relatives that we're just praising the Lord.
Okay, I grew up here. My dad had this store, and I have a lot of good memories about this area here. But I moved out, got married in 1947 and moved out. But I still like to come up here and just look around and think of the good old days. But I'll talk a little more in a little bit about some stuff.
My name's Mary Todd Miller. I was born August 3rd, 1930, right here, and grew up here, and we had a lot of fun right out here in this yard with all the children in the neighborhood. Liked to come here and play. We would just get out and play jump rope, hide and seek, and just things like that, but we really enjoyed growing up here and going to school. And we had a barn over there across the creek with cows and pigs and chickens, and I always liked to go. You had to walk across the foot log to get to the barn and go milk the cows. I loved doing that. But my mother and daddy were just the best. They were really good parents, and I thank God for them. Thank God for all my friends that are still around, and thank God for this beautiful day we have today.
I'm Naomi Hodges. I was born June 26, 1935, and I've lived here all my life. I come over here at Mr. Todd's store and get stuff for Mother, and I went to school where I live at, and I went there till 45.
I'm Sadie Todd Woods. I was born 1932. I guess I was Mom and Daddy's baby girl, but I'm 83 now. I'm no longer baby, I don't guess. But I had a lot of good memories here with Mom and Dad and our family, and still do.
I was born in a little shack down the road there on the side of the road. I moved over to this side on the main Buffalo Creek when I was 6 months old, and I was born May the 18th, 1989.
And
29.
You said
89.
I'm 89 years old.
Oh, he's 89.
And I live just across the mountain from the school, so I walked to school for 7 years, and didn't miss a day.
Oh, that's
great. And then I lived over there till I was grown. I went in the Air Force and come out and come back home. Lived there till I got married. I married a girl from Valdez. And
sounds hard, ain't it?
We had two kids. And she passed away a year and a half ago. So I give this land to my daughter and her son-in-law. We built a garage over there and put an apartment on top of it, and that's where I live now. And so I guess that's about it.
And I have the pictures. I'll show you to them. This is the old schoolhouse, and I live where it's at, and I'm drinking water that we drunk when we went to school there. My daddy went to school there, and got the same water. And I got pictures of all of us going to school. Everybody had to walk.
Yeah.
55 of us, we had to walk to school. Nobody, wasn't no roads, just wagon roads to get to school. And I have a lot of pictures of all of us going to school, Mary and all of us. I have them. And I got several of them of us all in the yard and in front of the schoolhouse. And I have my sister. This is my sister Evelyn in 1945 standing on the schoolhouse porch. And this one is the guys over here at Mr. Todd's old store building. And Riley and a whole bunch of them, their names are on the back. For them to get, I got their picture. And then this is a picture of older ones above me that went to school.
Nina's on there.
And Nina's on that, yes, she is. And I got some of the boys in the overhauls. They wore overhauls to school. And I got another one of all the boys in school. I went to school there. In the fourth grade, I went through the fourth grade, and they pulled it out in 45 to go to school. When I went to school there, I got one whipping in school for saying the word D. Our cows had a calf, and it's a little old bull calf, and I heard my dad say it was a D calf. Well, I went to school and told the teacher, and all of them, it was a D calf, and she tore me up, buddy. I mean, she did. I didn't say that no more. I mean, that weaned me. I was in the first grade, and the teacher would take up school at 8 o'clock. Well, she'd always sing that song, Old Black Joe, and my Country Tis of Thee, and then she'd have the Lord's Prayer, and then we went into our lesson, and she'd do the first grade had to go up on the first bench and do their lesson. Then the second, by that time in, it'd be recess, and we had a little recess. Well, after recess in, we went into the third grade and the fourth grade, and we'd have our lessons. And I've sung all my life, and if I had to sing, I had to go home and get my red rocking chair and go back up there and sing to them. But I had to sing in my red rocking chair. I remember that real well. And then we played ball. I've never seen ball played like it. The teacher would pitch a ball with a tennis ball. And if you hit the ball and you catch it and throw it in front of them before they got the first base or the second, wherever, you was automatically out. And I ain't seen no ball games like that since. But we played it, and every Sunday then we'd gang up on the school ground and play town ball. All day there'd be there'd be 100 people there or more, and we'd have a ball.
Let me just show the picture I have of the old Buffalo Cove School.
Great.
This was painted by Connie Watson, and it looks almost like it did then, but we had a lot of good memories there. And when it would snow or rain real hard, Daddy would drive his pickup over, and we wouldn't have to walk across the mountain and pick up a bunch of us and bring us home. A lot of good memories there.
Come around the high bank.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a good memory and a bad memory that happened right down there. We always had to have, my mother had a cook stove, burned wood. We had to chop a lot of wood. And one day she wanted a chicken. She made real good chicken and dumplings. So my brother and I, we caught this old chicken. And I was holding a chicken on the chop block by its legs. He come down with an axe, cut that chicken's head off, and the axe glanced off and cut three of my toes off. Of course, it's summertime and I was barefooted, and I ran to the house hollering and having three toes just a flapping. So they followed it up and took me to Lenore. There's a Dr. Wilson used to be in Lenore down below the old Carlisle Hotel. And you know, it was a long ways out of here then. The road was crooked then. Anyway, he laid me up on the table, washed that off with alcohol, and said, "Well, I can send you on to the hospital, but they'll just take them off." Said, "I think I'll sew them back on." So he did, and I still have my toes, but they're not, you know, he couldn't do leaders. They're not exactly perfect, but I'm glad he did that. That's one memory I have that happened right here.
Well, I remember that when that happened to Riley, I know
do
it.
Too.
There's a lot of blood, and it scared me so bad. I got mad at my brother for doing that. Well, I can remember my mom always packed our lunch. We took biscuits. We had biscuits with maybe sausage or ham or something like that. That's what we had for lunch, and a lot of times we carried our lunch in a bucket, like a tin bucket. I guess it was a syrup bucket or something. But anyway, we always had biscuits, and some of them at school would have something else besides biscuits, like peanut butter and cracker or something, and they'd want to trade with me. But my mother made cheese. We had cows all the time, and she made really good cheese. And she would fry that cheese. You remember that? It was so good. And sometimes we'd have a fried cheese biscuit for lunch.
It was good, too.
And I remember one girl especially, she always wanted to trade me and get my fried cheese biscuit for lunch.
Yeah. My dad sold lard in the store in a bucket of lard.
Yeah,
it was the right size for a lunch box to take to school. About everybody had a
pound. Was it a pound or 2 pounds?
It was
5 pounds.
Pretty good size.
I can remember we didn't have loaf bread like we have now so much. And sometimes Daddy would bring a loaf of bread back, maybe two, and Mama would take them, put them in the dining room drawer because we couldn't use it every day. And Mary and I'd go in there and just open the drawer and smell of it. I remember that so clearly. Smelling of the loaf bread.
I know it.
I remember when I was going to school, when school was out at 3:15, we had chores to do. Well, my job was carry in coal and go feed the chickens. Well, instead of doing that, we played ball till dark. And it got dark, and my mother come in and seen the wood and stuff wasn't in. She made us take a lantern and go to the coal men and wood men, and we were scared to death. We were crying, didn't want to go, afraid to go. But we did it, but that weaned us. When then the school was out, we done our chores, and then we played ball. I mean, it just well yesterday.
How about hardships as a child? Any hard times? Anybody?
We didn't know it was hard times.
We didn't either. My father was blind and crippled. He couldn't walk nor see. But he was smart on a lot of things, but he'd been blind since he's 33 years old.
Of course, it was in the Great Depression, you know, when we were growing up, but we didn't know. We always had plenty of cornbread to eat and milk and things like that. We we grew, had a big garden. We always had plenty to eat. Get out and pick blackberries. And
we did too.
Well, now let's talk about your schools and what your school was like and your teachers and how the schoolroom looked and how it was heated and so on. Can you tell me about that?
Well, I remember Mr. Rob Miller. He was our teacher. We had first, second, and third grade in one side of this old school building. And then just you walk across a little, like a closet place, and you had the 4th, 5th, 6th, and 7th were all in the second room. And this little middle room, I remember one day some boys disobeyed him, and he took them in there and gave them a good swarping and a good talk. Yeah, and I was scared to death. Our parents never whipped us like that. But that was one of the things I remember.
I remember we'd have a revival meeting here at the church sometimes the last 2 weeks. Mr. Rob Miller would bring all the kids from the school across that mountain and come with a morning service, 10 o'clock service, and take us back to school.
We liked that.
That was Jack Hill right there.
Yeah. Come across the hill.
But he was real strict. A cousin of mine came down and lived a while, and he got into something over there in the school. Mr. Miller had these big switches. He got asked from that switch, and this boy, he jumped out the window and come back home.
Oh,
he never did go back to school.
Who was that?
Harley Smith.
Oh, Harley.
I remember that.
I know I was afraid when I first started school. I'd heard everybody talking about Mr. Miller, how mean he was. And I was so afraid when I started the school in the first grade. I was scared to death of him. I think I was just in his room 1 year, and then Miss Talbert came.
What got me was, I had Mr. Miller for the whole 7 years, and he was a man of his word, I'll tell you. He'd be writing on the blackboard and somebody get into something.
He had eyes in the back of his
head. He'd turn right around and give him a whipping. Somebody said, "How you do all that?" He said, "I got eyes in the back of my head." And he was, boy, I'll tell you. I remember one time, Billy Taylor lived out there. Everybody would play tag when they started home, you know. So I was kind of sick, and I was moping across the yard. And he come along and hit me between my shoulders. It almost knocked the breath out of me, you know. So it flew all over me. I went up the side of that head with it, you know, with my fist. Mr. Miller was locking the door, and he saw me. So he took me back in, and he laid it to me, buddy. And I come back out, and then I was mad then because he didn't whip him. So I told him, I said, "He give me mine." I said, "I'll give you yours." I said, "The next time I went to the store and walked across this hill right here, we know where he lived, he come right by the store. He come out there and started talking to him, you know, and I tore into him." Yeah, I don't know. But at home there, I was the only boy. I had two sisters. It was a kind of a hard road to hoe. Well, I had to cut wood for a fireplace, cut wood for a cook stove. We had a horse to feed. I always kept two hogs. And that's what I had to do. That's what I did till it got dark. And then I did my homework by a lamp. And but my mother, she helped me out. She put the two girls in the kitchen and whatever, house cleaning, and she helped me. And I just thank the good Lord for her. She really brought me up, and what little I am now, I mean, I owe it to her. I have to say that. And so we was talking one time about smoking and drinking. And my dad, I'm sorry to say, but he did a lot of drinking and smoking. So I told her one day, I said, "Could you explain to me why it is so hard for anybody to quit drinking or smoking?" I said, "Everybody you see is taking pills for this and pills for that to keep them doing it, you know." She says, "Oh, I'll tell you something." She said, "The only thing I know what you don't ever start, you don't have to quit. I thought about that. And I met Carl Robbins here. We were just like brothers. So we got together and got to talking. And we, like I say, we were closer than brothers. So we made a pact never to drink and never to smoke. He said, if you'll stick by it, I will. I said, it's a deal. So as far as I know, it's went all the way through. And Carl died about 5 months ago. And if he ever started, I don't ever know it. But in other words, I just thank my mother for that and the good Lord that he guided me into it. So I'm not much, but I mean,
yeah,
she really started me off right anyway.
Rob Miller gave us a history test, and I loved history. I always made straight A's on history because I liked history. So one of the questions he wrote on the board was, when was the War of 1812? And every one of them in the room missed it but me. And I was the only one who wrote down 18 and 12. I never forget that.
Sort of a trick one.
It threw them off. I thought that was so funny.
I remember before we had electricity here, my dad would take his pickup truck and go to the ice plant in Lenoir.
Yeah, I remember
that. Buy a big old block of ice, wrap it up in the canvas, bring it back up and put it in the ice chest. Those people really thought it's something to get a cold drink.
Yeah.
And another thing I remember, we didn't make ice cream here except in the wintertime. When the creek would freeze over, my brother and I'd go over with a burlap sack and bust ice out of the creek. Bust it up. We had an old freezer. And we had cows. We had some really good ice cream. But it's in the wintertime.
I remember my dad used to go and get this ice you're talking about.
Yeah.
He'd go over and dig a big hole in a sawdust pile and put it in there.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it would stay. Mm-hmm. It would stay for a long, long time.
Yeah.
To make ice cream, you know, whatever with. I seen him plant take potatoes and didn't have no way to keep them. They dig a hole in the ground.
Yeah.
Pack it with leaves or something, then put leaves and stuff over the top of it, not so deep, and they would keep.
Yeah. We did that right out there, Jones. We put straw down, put potatoes in, straw on top, and cover it over.
Yeah.
I'd have to go out there and dig out the potatoes when
yeah,
she wanted some.
Yeah.
Herb, you thought of anything to say yet?
Yeah, Bill, I was born in 1930, in 1936, when I was just 6 years old. We were living, you ask about hard times, you know, we were living in a rented house at that time. And I developed double pneumonia. No penicillin, it usually meant death, really. And I remember my dad took me to Catawba Hospital in Hickory. And the doctor there at that time, that was our family doctor, Dr. Lewis. He made an incision in between my ribs and put a tube in there into my lung. And they ran a tube out, and I remember when I got back home, we ran it into a half a gallon fruit jar, and it smelled terrible. The scent was bad. And I think everybody thought I wasn't going to make it. I was in the bed I was flat on my back for 9 weeks. And finally I was healed, really, and I know where the healing came from. And those were really, really hard times back then. I remember a little later in life, I guess I was about
10 or 11 years old at that time. We had managed to, our dad had managed to build a house. We did have a home of our own at that time. And of course he was in debt for that. And I remember Mom, I've got a sister that's 2 years older than me. And I remember Mom calling my sister and I in one day, and she said, kid, sit down. I want to have a talk with you. She said, it's getting very close to Christmas, and there's not going to be any gifts this year. She said, we're just having it so tough. But I want you to know ahead of time so you won't be disappointed. And we knew it was tough. You know, we accepted that. We didn't complain about it. It was just that way. And I remember the night before Christmas, I had a dream. And I saw in that dream, we had a little Christmas tree on a table in the living room. And I remember in that dream, I saw that Christmas tree, and I saw two little boxes under that tree. Christmas morning, I woke up and got out of bed and went into the living room, and there was exactly what I saw in my dream. I've never appreciated a gift any more than that one. And I'm 85 years old now.
Very emotional moment.
Yes.
That reminds me of a Christmas. I don't know how old Mary and I were. We weren't very big. Mama fixed the tree, and there's two little gifts laying under there. You might remember this, Mary. And it was about this size. And we'd go in, look, turn it over, and try to figure out what it was. And inside was one of the big, when we Christmas came, big Hershey bars out of the store with a $20 bill, and I thought we had hit it rich. Do you remember that? I never will forget that, because we kept looking at it, and we could not figure out what it was. I don't know what I did with the $20 bill. I don't remember. That was a good memory.
I didn't tell you what was in those little boxes.
No, you didn't, Herb.
It was a very inexpensive pen and pencil set.
Really?
Yeah.
Pen and pencil.
That's great.
Bill, I was born in 1928, and I just thinking, when we were born here, there's a lady lived over in Darby, Wilkes County. They called her Aunt Sally Hatton. She's a black lady, and she is a midwife.
She delivered me.
When one of us kids was to be born, Dad would go over there and bring her over here.
You remember her?
So she did.
That was good to have a midwife in the community. Because it's so far out to Lenore, you know.
No, I thought it same.
Don't you have a birth certificate?
Yeah. I guess I was the only one that didn't have Aunt Sally had. I think Dr. Wilson delivered me. I was born in 1932.
Aunt Sally Hatton delivered me. And
really?
Yeah, Hazel. Yeah. Evelyn.
She was good.
Yeah.
And you know, back then there wasn't any electricity or
no,
anything.
No, we had lamps.
No electricity.
Yeah.
Or,
well. In a few years, Mr. Granville Hawkins up here was a forest warden, and he had one of these telephones that you wind up, you mm-hmm. know. And that really put us in high tech up here in Buffalo. We could go up there and make a call.
Yeah.
And the doctors would come out here if we get real sick.
I remember that.
Dad would go to the doctor. They would come here to the house. Don't you remember?
You know, the first time I ever used a telephone,
it's
when I enlisted in the Air Force.
Really?
It's the first television I've seen.
What year would that have been?
50.
1950.
That's the first television I'd seen. They had one in Charlotte. In the waiting room, you know, where we got enlisted, where we got sworn in. That's the first TV I seen, and the first, well, I didn't talk then on the phone, but 50 was the first year that I ever used a telephone.
I remember Riley and Buna, our brothers, passed away, listening to the radio sometime in the evening about 5 o'clock. What was it? Y'all get up close to the radio, and it was some kind of a program you and Buna liked. Maybe Lone Ranger or something.
Probably like Jack, Jack Armstrong.
We used to listen to the radio as an old battery radio.
Yeah.
We'd listen to the Grand Ole Opry.
Yeah.
And when they'd advertise, we'd cut it off till it...
Can
it come back on and turn it on?
Save your battery.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That sure is different from today's when our great grandsons have all these pads they can do everything on now.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
That's true. That is true. My daddy had a battery radio.
Really?
And every Saturday night, Nora Robbins and her family and Joe Coffey's family come down to our house, listen to Grand Ole Opry.
Yeah.
Aww. Every Saturday night.
That's the way we used to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I know when Dad got one in the store here, everybody would gather in and stay and listen to Lum and Abner.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
Amos and Andy.
Amos and Andy.
Times have
changed. That was in the good old days.
Yeah, the good old days. That's
absolutely
right.
Absolutely, to me it is.
Yeah.
Mary mentioned the doctors would come out, you know, to their houses. I'm going to tell this. I don't know whether Mary would will appreciate it or not.
We're going to tell something on you.
But when our first child was born, we and Mary got out of the hospital. We brought her and the baby here to her mother's house and her mother and father's house. And the first night, I believe, that she was home, was here, we became concerned about her, and I went up the road here to the telephone that the guys were talking about up at Mr. Granville Hawkins, and I called Dr. Trapper, and I told him that I was concerned about Mary. He said, I'll be there shortly. And he did. He came on up and was very gracious. And when he got ready to leave, he said, you know, I'm just about out of gas in the car. And I believe, Riley, at that time, Mr. Todd wasn't selling gas. Was there a period of time there that he didn't sell gas? And so I went out to my car. I had a 49 Mercury at that time. And I ciphered enough gasoline out of my car and put it in his car to get him back to Lenore.
Oh, good doctor.
Yeah. I know he's going to school. The boys' toilet was up here on your left, and the girls was out here on your right.
Yeah.
Well, Herman Coffey and Burn Coffey come back from the bad toilet, and they got in a fight there in the yard. And Vern Coffey and Herman Coffey, and Rob Miller asked them, how did they spell coffee? And this boy said C-O-F-F-E-Y, and they started fighting again. He had to separate them. They got in a fight coming back from the boys' toilet. They were hitting right and left.
You know, they're always getting in fights.
Yeah, they were always
fights.
Yeah.
I remember fights. Scare me in school. Now they got the
I can remember when, you remember when the old woodshed set out behind?
Yeah.
They'd have some of the guys had cut trees and cut them in chunks and blocks about this long. And some of them was probably this big. And out back, I didn't put them in that shed. And I went out there and cut wood, busted wood several times to build a fire in that big old stove they had there in the school.
Yeah. Yeah, you know, I remember, I guess it was Mrs. Link was the teacher then.
Yeah.
I don't know if it was our dog or whose it was, but she would let this dog come in and lay by the
lead.
Lay by the heater.
Yeah.
That's unusual, wasn't it?
Yeah. He'd follow you to school.
I know,
and
that
big old yellow and brown dog.
Yeah,
you know, she lived up there
in that little
where you had the trailer.
Yeah.
And I walked across that mountain there, you know, down to the other side. And each time I'd go through, that dog would try to bite me. I'd get me a switch, you know, and I was afraid to do it. If I do it, I was afraid she'd jump on me. So I'd get me a switch and I kept swarfing it, you know. And while I got irritated, I grabbed up a stick about this big around about that long, and she come out. She said, "He don't understand what that means. You left to get a switch." I said, "Lady, the way me, I'm going to work on it, he'll understand it." But I went on. And he tried to bite me every time I went by there. I thought about that. I used all that bread and let him lay by the stove.
You know, Mr. Todd, big old dog, would follow you to school. And Rob Miller would let him come in. He'd go in there and lay on that pot-bellied stove. Then after a while, he'd go to the door and he'd let him out. He'd leave then.
You remember the big old dog? We'd get out for lunch. And we'd sit on the edge of the road there in the grass. You know, and had lunch. Everybody was sitting out there. There was a big old dog. I don't remember who he belonged to. But he would sit there and he'd just look at you, you know. And he'd look at you as funny as, well, you had to give him something to eat, you know. He stayed there every day. He was there every day, just as merits as we was.
Well, didn't you hit Adair Hawkins in the side of the head with a big old cat-eye biscuit?
I had a big biscuit and it was full of rice. And he kept irritating me.
Full of rice.
I hauled off and threw it and it went in his ear. And then they had to pick it out.
Rob Miller was a good teacher, though, wasn't
he?
Yeah,
he
wanted you to do your work. I learned under Rob Miller.
I went to him all 7 years I was over there.
Yeah, he's a good teacher.
He's kind of strict, but good.
Yeah, he was.
Oh, he was strict. He was straight out.
And we were always allowed to have prayer if we, you know, most of the teachers
sure did.
Yeah, sure did. Yeah. They can't do
if you come every day, you... That missing a day, you got a half holiday.
Yeah,
but if you miss a day, you have to sit in the room while the kids play outside. Yeah. We always look forward to that.
You know, my dad went to school to him.
Really?
I don't know where, but somewhere. Because somebody was talking about him. And he said they were, when they were in school, he got into something. And he swore to you about anything he had in his hand. And he had a pencil. And he come over and he hit my daddy on top of the head. And it broke, the pencil broke and the pointer flew and stuck in Tom Pops' eye.
Oh,
Dad told me that many of you, but I didn't know Miss Miller was that old, but I knew he was pretty old. But he told me that's what happened.
Well, when Rob Miller was teaching too, you remember the shoe boy that was sick, and Rob, he come to school, and when he made water, it piled up on the ground. And so Rob knew he was real sick, so he's going to take him to the doctor next morning, but you remember he died?
I don't remember that.
Which one?
It's a shoe, one of Matt's shoes boys.
Oh, yeah. No.
I forget his name.
Which
but
one?
Rob's going to take him to school.
The one that
doctor.
Died? Joe. You mean when they lived up Old Field Creek?
It's an older boy. I went to school with Jones in college.
Well, now, Joe was old. You remember Dick?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was older. Joe was older than he was. He come home from school one night. They lived way up on Old Field Creek.
Right.
He come home from school, and he died that night.
Yeah.
And he was, his name was Joe. He was a year or not a year, but older than Dick.
I know Rob was going to take him to the doctor next morning, but he had died that night.
Yeah, he died that night. I don't know what his problem was.
Yeah. Sometimes somebody come up to me and lived in here in the past. We was very blessed to have a good mother and a good dad.
That's right.
And she said that the mother would... she's good. She made clothes. She made our clothes a lot.
Yeah.
But this little girl come up this path, and she knew she needed a dress, so she got a
bead sack.
It was kind of flowery. And next time she come by, she gave that little girl a dress. And Naomi's sister told me one time they'd always come into the store. said as they come across the foot log, they made sure that my mother heard them a coming. They talked real loud, because she'd come out and bring them some cookies or something.
Yeah. We'd talk real loud so she'd hear us. I know we come here one time and went up at the store and they was two pretty dresses hanging up there. And Miss Todd come up there and got them, give them to me and Evelyn. Boy, we thought we had us in heaven. We had a new dress. But something else going to school too, I remember. The boys would play and they'd play horsey. And a bunch of them got a rope and tied it around Horace Green, and Miss Link had a fish pond there. You remember that fish pond?
Yeah.
And they drug him in the fish pond and drug him out and wet him all over. He just raising, chained and crying, but he was wet all over. Well, they drug him in the fish pond, Horace Green. That some of the Vance Wilkes and a bunch of them drug him through the fish pond. Clothes and all.
But what about 1929 and the Depression? Did it affect anybody here? Or did life just go on as usual?
That's for my time.
Yeah, mine too.
Yeah, that was ahead of me too.
I remember people would gather greens, anything in the woods like fern, sprays, and galax, and Dad would buy it and sell it for them.
You remember that little plant they had, they called lobelia?
Yeah. Lobelia, yeah.
Oh, I they forgot about that.
Put that over there, you know. And that galax, they made ferns.
Christmas decorations.
For decorations.
Shipped it up north.
Life was about the same for a lot of people, and our family was one of them. But, you know,
they'd come over and swap this for stuff out of the store there, you know.
Yeah.
And I know this lady up there used to have chickens. She'd come over and trade a chicken to Mr. Todd for some food, you know. And he had the big long building he had over there. Mm-hmm. Well, he had stuff like that in it. And then he also had feed, like feed for cows and horses and stuff, you know.
Yeah.
The big long building. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
And he used that building for all of his trading and his feed and stuff.
Well, was that building, long building that was there, was that the first store or was this the first store?
That was the old original Buffalo Mercantile store. I don't remember it.
Yeah.
But when he got ready to build this building, he moved out into that warehouse there while he was building this one.
Didn't
Is that
know.
Not right?
Yeah, that's right.
He was just in it while we were...
I don't remember that one. Because I wouldn't...
No, I don't remember
I wouldn't get enough... I wasn't big enough to get out, you know, so I don't remember then. This is the only store that I can remember.
Yeah, me too.
They used this lumber in this building come out of the old mercantile building.
Yeah.
They tore it down and built this one. The windows and the doors. Come out of the old building.
Hmm.
And I've heard some of the old people talk when I was a kid. The road was so bad out of here, they had to build a flume and float the lumber out.
Yeah.
From here out.
And it started right back here.
Yeah.
And there used to still be parts of it there.
Boards in the creek like this across.
And down we'd go swimming over there.
Yeah.
Yeah, my granddaddy said he was at one time helping nail the boards together right here, that lay one up over the top of the other and put one nail down through it where it could
move
like this with the current.
From here all the way down to where the dam is.
Yeah.
The place where we live, the old homestead now, he bought it from some of your relatives. He was a miller.
That's probably my granddaddy.
Remember, huh?
Lee, I bet.
Lee, I guess he was my granddaddy.
Who?
Lee Miller.
It was some of your relatives. Because the place he bought, it was the miller had it.
Mm-hmm.
I remember telling me, and I forgot what his name was. So.
My nose is going to be sunburned red.
Yeah.
But we moved over there when I was 6 months old. from this side of Dorman's. You know where the trailer sits at the rock? There was a little shack there beside the road. You look, it was about
I'll put them back
the height
in
of a car. You could look down and see the cars go
I
by. They was coming
down,
right
I
by
done
them.
And, told me.
And that's where I was born.
Mm-hmm.
And then she said, Mom said 6 months while we moved over there.
Well, let's move on up to maybe World War II.
I'll tell you how big I was, but I'm ashamed to.
How about World War II? How did that affect everybody in Happy Valley and Buffalo? Or did life just go on?
Well, they moved the CC camp up here in, was that 39 or 40?
Before the flood.
It was there during the 40 flood because they helped with the road situation during the flood.
Because they helped look for Nana, you know.
Yeah. When the war started, they moved all those boys out. They went into the military service. There's a lot of boys from here went into service. Jones, you might know a lot about that, because I never did go in.
Oh yeah, I remember when the CC camp was here. And a lot of them boys, when the war broke out, they went in. I mean, they took them. And I was still in high school. And when I graduated when I was 16. And I would have been 17 in 2 days. So I wasn't in the draft age till a year and a half, 2 years later. And then as quick as I got 18, they drafted me. And I had a cyst on my back. And they turned me down on account of that. And so I had it took off, and they never did draft me no more. And I didn't volunteer till Korea broke out, and then I enlisted then.
How about drives for rubber and iron back during World War II? Did you have drives like that down here?
At Happy Valley School, I remember they had it. And they had the whole parking lot up there, just a big mound of all kind of stuff.
I know when I graduated, they liked to never found a place where they could get a graduation ring.
Yeah.
And then you got what they had, and that's it. Let's see, Dot and I graduated together. And Adair would have been with us if he hadn't had, he was bedridden for a year, but he was supposed to be in with us. Then that kicked him back till him and Bernard graduated together then, the next year. But Dot and I went together 7 years over here and all down through there. Graduated every day of school. We were in the same class and whatever.
Well, Jones, why was Adair bedridden so long?
He had rheumatic fever.
I remember that.
Yeah, he was bedridden for a year. Well, they thought he wasn't going to make it. So the river creek was froze over with ice. And he wanted to be baptized. So they went down to the creek and broke the ice and baptized him. And after that, he got better.
Really?
I don't know whether that cold water had anything to do with the fever or not. It might have. But anyway, then he got all right. They thought he wasn't going to make it.
You remember that?
To Lynn.
I remember where he's always in bed, couldn't do nothing.
I knew he had rheumatic fever, but I didn't know he baptized.
I remember Riley and I were baptized together same Sunday up the road here in the river.
One August morning, that creek was cold.
It was.
1946, wasn't it?
Yeah.
I'll tell you, as fast as this water flows and all the shade and all, it stays cold.
Yeah.
As far as going swimming, I used to do it, but I mean, look, we used to go swimming all the time, but it always stayed cold. But then it didn't bother me. I just kid, you know.
Riley and Buna caught a lot of fish down here, and Mama fixing for supper, I remember.
Right.
I don't know what kind they were, even.
Just any kind.
Catfish, and it was good.
Yeah. I used to catch a lot of fish when Dad and them sawmills, you know, up on ahead of Buffalo.
Yeah.
I used to catch a lot of fish, a lot of catfish and eels.
I caught an eel up here one time.
Since the 40 flood, there is no eels. I don't know what, and catfish, you don't see very many of them. You get all the way down to the valley.
Did you eat those eels?
You have to eat them when they're hot. You cut them off
when they're hot.
Chunks about this long.
When they get cold, they ain't
you eat them while they're hot. When they get cold, they're raw.
That's right.
Really?
There was a puddle in Miss Miller's field over there, about as big as this right here. Just in the middle of the field, it was just. There's a tree there, and it had blowed up. The water had washed it off, and it left a big old place about this big, and it was up, his waist deep, I guess. And Maynard caught the last eel out of that whole water that I'd ever seen up here. But there used to be just plenty of them. I don't know what the flood had to do with it, but they didn't, there was no more.
I remember that 40 flood. I remember the water was right there up to that, right where that building, that old building is.
Yeah. Over there where I live, used to come up the creek and up the bank to the house. Mm-hmm. There was a high place there. We stood on that bank and looked at that creek go down through Mr. Miller's field over there.
Yeah.
And I have seen, I'm not exaggerating, but I've seen hemlock trees as big as that one, the bits as big around, the whole thing just go right on down the river.
Really?
Do you remember the big rock that laid right there where you turned across the big field to go to the schoolhouse?
Mm-hmm, I do.
I guess it's 12 or 14 feet long. And round. It looked, and there was the shape more like an egg than anything I can imagine.
Beautiful rock.
And it was laying right there on top of the bank, just like I'd set this cane up. Nothing under it or nothing, just... And that rock was gone. Nobody's ever... The only thing I can figure it was when the water got on it and rolled it in the creek, as it come down the creek, it busted, you know, and shattered and...
Probably so, yeah.
Busted it up.
Well, we're almost at an hour now. Do y'all want to go on, or you want to kind of call it quits?
I'm through.
Yeah, Lord.
I'm
thinking
of all kinds.
I remember that 40 flood.
When that flood come, this little old branch down through here, coming out to the house, and the creek was getting up and coming up this way. When we left to go up to the church, this little old branch really gets up.
Well, the whole schoolhouse was covered in water, and there was water to the road.
Riley, can
water
you remember how,
our house, but my daddy
how the creek come before the flood?
Where, over your way or here?
Yeah. You know where Mr. Taylor lived?
Mm-hmm.
Where Sergius bought the house, you know?
Yeah.
The road used to come up through there.
And there
was a big field there, a big rock over there, a swimming hole. That's where we go swimming.
What?
Now, after the 40 flood, it's just like this right here.
Yeah.
And if you left from up there to go to town, if it rained, you'd run through the creek, because it was all right there.
Yeah.
What was the name of those big rock cliffs around there?
Yeah.
Did they have a name?
So Dad told him.
He didn't.
He said, I'll give you a right-of-way across here if you will build a road. And it come out over on Scuffletown.
Yeah.
And they told him, says, you can't do it. Dad said, well, I'll try anyway. So he gave him a right-of-way, and they built that road across there, and it come out over it.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you couldn't get down the creek. There was no way.
Yeah.
Hi, folks. It's great to have you here, and it's great to be here. It's a rewarding privilege to be part of such a great legacy. And while we can't duplicate the past, hopefully we can keep part of that history here and bring it into the future, and as we grow and develop some of our own, hopefully, in, you know, years down the road. But it's wonderful to see you, and wonderful to have the children of Pearl and J.C. Todd here, and Naomi, and you, sir.
Jones.
And I'm glad you're here, and I'm glad to be here. We're glad to be here. So I wanted to offer you folks, if you want to come in afterwards, we'll have some food. You can have pizza, sandwiches, Mary special, and your namesake. And so just happy to be here, and I hope you folks had a great time. Great day reminiscing.
We're glad you're here.
Yes.
Yeah. We're glad
appreciate
you're here.
You. Yeah.
Thank you.
I just want to thank everybody for showing up today on behalf of Caldwell Heritage Museum in Caldwell County Now and Then. We're now joint partners. So thanks everybody for being here.
Sounds great.
This is the place where the old Buffalo Cove Schoolhouse used to be. My daddy bought it in 49, and I've lived here all my life. And I'm drinking water that my father drank when he went to school here. The water's up the road right yonder at the spring. And I've lived here my lifetime. I inherited all of this in 1975.
And Naomi says the spring was up this road right here. And how old is that barn, Naomi?
85 years old.
85 years old.
Yep. This is Naomi Hodges. I'm telling Bill about this mill rock. My grandmother was 3 years old when she moved to Buffalo. Her family moved to Buffalo. And they was grinding corn on this mill rock at the Reese Falls. And the 40 flood took it down. And I was down there hunting grapes and found the mill rock. And my husband got it for me and made me out a picnic table out of it.
I wanted you to see Naomi's photos much better than in the video. So I went down to Naomi's and scanned these photos and restored them. And that's what you're going to see here.
All right, this is, I am Naomi Hodges. I'm showing the school where I went to school. This is a picture of our schoolhouse that I went here till I was in the fourth grade. And in 45, they pulled it out to Happy Valley. They was 52 kids went to school here, and they all had to walk. This is a picture of all of us in school taken at the end of the schoolhouse in 1944. And there was 52 kids, and we all went to school here, and everybody had to walk. Nobody ever drove because there wasn't no vehicles. All the kids had to walk to school. And I lived next door, and I didn't have to walk just across the yard to the schoolhouse. This is another picture of all of us in the front yard with our school teacher, and they made pictures, and we all went to school here. Every one of us did. And this is another picture of all of us. Our teacher this is on the left side. Everybody, when you went through the first to the third on this side, and then when you got in the fourth grade, you had to go over across in the other side. But we all went to school here together. And this is a picture of older kids that went to school here before I went to school. But they all went to school here like us and had to walk just like everybody else did. And this is a picture of the boys at Mr. Todd's store where he sold his stuff. And there's all around a bicycle. And this is a picture of some more boys taken in front of the schoolhouse. And they're all wearing their overalls. Back then, a lot of them wore their overalls. All right, here's one more picture of all the boys in their overalls. And they wore their overalls to school. When they went home, they had to pull their overalls off and wear old clothes because they had to wear their overalls back to school the next day. That's what they wore to school.
Hi, I'm Bill Tate with Caldwell County Now and Then on Facebook. If you like what we do at Caldwell County Now and Then, please donate to our local museum, the Caldwell Heritage Museum, 112 Vaden Street, Lenoir, North Carolina. Thank you.